He's going to start this morning. He's going to share a testimony. It's going to be about healing and about some other things as well. And I want to share this with you.
You can make me fall off the chair.
I'm trying to. Dick says to me, he says, Pastor Rick, this is long. He wasn't the first one to tell me this, so I wasn't worried because I know that this is what's supposed to happen. So I'm telling you all this. We're not going to keep you here until 3 in the afternoon because Kevin would be upset when you have to eat the hot dogs. I'm going to be watching the time. We might not get through all three of these testimonies today. And if we don't, that's okay. And I might interrupt partway through this testimony because there might be a time where we're going to just have prayer in the midst of the testimony. He's first, and then there are people that's coming after him. And I want you to give him your undivided attention. Just as simple as that. Dick's got some great things to share. You don't want to miss any. Go ahead, Dick.
Good morning, good morning. Good morning. Praise be to God. I don't know what to say because I've never had to go through this, but there are so many things that God has helped me with. There's so many things he's done for me. Some of which I didn't even know until after, he had done them. Anyways, my name is Dick Roth. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dick Roth for those who do know me, except for Kevin and maybe Vito, they have some other names for me. Anyways, up until, and oh, by the way, I am not originally from this area. I'm originally from Cleveland, Ohio. I hope you don't hold that against me. It was one of our northern industrial cities, and just a little bit of a historical background. It was pretty nasty, as most of your northern industrial cities were. And it has the honor of having one of the few or only rivers that ever caught fire. Cuyahoga River caught fire one day. It burned up some bridges and some of the warehouses along the edge. And as the Cleveland Plain Deer, the local paper, put it, the river doesn't flow, it just kind of oozes. And no one has ever drowned, and they just decay away. Anyways, that's where I started up until about 20 years ago. I started smoking, as my father did. I tried to quit smoking a lot of times and failed. And actually, I smoked about 2.5 packs of cigarettes a day, along with 3 to 4 pots of coffee. And if I didn't have a cigarette or a cup of coffee in my mouth, it wasn't me. I had since moved to Pennsylvania, and at that time, Pennsylvania kept putting more taxes on cigarettes. At that time, I think a carton of cigarettes was like about $13, and now I don't smoke, but I think it's probably up to around 40 or 50 now. But I had tried to quit many times. However, I suffered terrible withdrawal symptoms, and I wasn't the nicest person to be around. Actually, I was pretty intolerable. Plus, being a not-so-smart person that I was at the time, I would throw the cigarettes and the lighter and the matches and everything away, thinking that would help me to quit, only having to go out and buy them all back again when I failed. I even tried hypnosis at one time. I went and got hypnotized, which seemed to be very good. Unfortunately, at that time, I had to get on a plane flight to Los Angeles, and it's about a 4.5-hour flight. Unfortunately, the hypnosis wore off in about 2 hours halfway through the flight. So there's probably people out there still who will attest that that was not the best flight they had ever been on because of the way I dealt with having to quit and the withdrawal symptoms. Anyways, the nurse there, the flight attendant thought that it was a great flight. Other than that, they were glad it was over. So then, after that, like I said, we moved to Pennsylvania. And one day driving across the Cross Valley, actually I don't even think it was Cross Valley, it was a place at the time, said, "Put those cigarettes down, and I will help you to quit." Well, being a smarter person at this time, I didn't throw everything away. However, I never had 1 ounce of withdrawal, and to this day, I've never picked up another cigarette.
Hallelujah.
However, that wasn't without further issues. A while back, they thought that my heartbeat was a little slow. I never did, but it was just a thing I used to do when my dad was in the hospital. I'd sit there and see how my heart was beating. It normally ran around 40 to 50, 49 to 50. Other than one day I was sitting in the airport here waiting for my son to come back from a flight from Colorado, I was feeling a little funk. So my wife said to go to the hospital. And when I got there, my doctor said, "I don't think this is too good. I want you to put a halter on." So I wore a halter for 2 days. And when I went back, he said, "We need to talk about this because your heart was only at the one couple times it was only beating 20 per minute." So he thought that was a little too slow. Although I was feeling fine. Anyways, he said I had to have a pacemaker put in. So about 15 years ago, I had a pacemaker put in, and I have to get it has to get replaced about every 5 years because, contrary to popular belief, the pacemaker is a battery in itself. It's not a separate unit. So every 5 years, they wear out and have to get it replaced, and it's a pretty simple operation. They just cut a thing, pull the old one off, put the new one in, as long as your leads into your heart are still stable. And I asked him if, I asked the doctors, why can't they just put a zipper in and make it a lot easier? He didn't seem to see the humor. Anyways, God has been with me through all these operations, and right now it's kind of like falling off the log because he is there. I also inherited a kidney disease from my mother, and knowing that my kidneys would deteriorate over the years and would eventually fail. So one evening I was sitting on the couch and I was kind of tired, and my son looked at me and he said that I was beginning to fade away, and he called 911 immediately. And when he got me to the hospital, my blood sugar was almost 1,000. Knowing that the normal is around 70 to 99. And the doctors I heard them talking, and they wondered why I was still alive. And they didn't know why, but I knew why. Because I had a mighty God looking out for me. Anyways, they kept me in the hospital until my blood sugar was under control. And then sooner thereafter, soon thereafter, I went on dialysis, which is not a pleasant thing to have to do, especially if you have to go into the clinic. Anyways, I'm not going to expound on it. But anyways, when I was on dialysis, and if they're not careful while you're on dialysis, your blood pressure might get too low, and you can pass out. So after one session, I got up, and lucky my son was there. And I just, if I hadn't been on it long, flat on my face. Anyways, I thought it was just from the blood pressure and they hadn't been watching out close enough. But they said I had a mild heart attack. So the ambulance rushed me to Wolfsburg General Hospital, where they automatically did an angioplasty procedure. So my heart doctor said that I had a double blockage and that they were unable to perform that sort of procedure at the general here. So they loaded me on a helicopter and life-flighted me to the University of Pennsylvania Hospital System down in Philadelphia. Now, I don't know if anybody's ever really wanted to fly in a helicopter, but it felt like the space that I had was about like that wide. It felt like the nurse was sitting on my chest, which wasn't a good thing. And it was a beautiful evening. It was a summer evening. It was warm. The stars were out. But it was a terribly bumpy ride. And not very comfortable. So if you ever wanted to do that, I suggest that maybe you might want to take that off your bucket list. So on the following Sunday evening, in the middle of the night, Dr. J, I'm sorry, performed a double bypass on me. And the reason they call him Dr. J is because he's got about every letter of the alphabet in his name. A few months thereafter, I was able to go home, and on dialysis, and at which time I also put my name in for a list to get a transplant. Kidney transplant, and which normally takes around 3 to 5 years, depending on the length of the list and depending on the type of kidney you sign up for. Now, that may sound funny, but there's like different 4 types of kidneys you can sign up for. You can sign up for a kidney that's perfect, doesn't have any problems, any person didn't have any illnesses. Sign up for one where maybe the person was on was diabetic or whatever. Then they have one where they might have been a drug user and so forth. And then the last one is I'll take anything I can get. So I signed up for the middle one, and not 3 to 5 years, but only after 6 months. Guess whose hand was on this one? I got a call on my cell phone from the University of Pennsylvania Hospital. It was noon on a Saturday afternoon. I just was down in Wilkes-Barre here getting a haircut, and they said a kidney had become available. And they thought I probably should have it because in 3 to 5 years they didn't know, because of my heart transplant, they didn't know if my heart would be strong to take the operation. Anyways, I had about 5 minutes to make the decision, which didn't give me a lot of time. I mean, they told me that the gentleman had had a heart attack, and that they had damaged the tube that goes from the kidney into the bladder when they took it out. But the surgeons thought that would be okay to be able to repair that. So I called my wife immediately. She packed up everything. And when I got home, and an hour later, we headed to the University of Pennsylvania Hospital. I had about a 4-hour window of time at that because they had to prepare the kidney in New Jersey where it was coming from and prepare it for transportation and then the flight over. And then when I got to the hospital, they had to prepare the kidney for transplant. They had to prepare me and get me ready. So at 7 p.m. that night, I had the kidney transplant. And I immediately, And because I still had a problem with my kidneys, I had to be on dialysis even though I was getting a heart operation. So they used what they call a mobile unit. So anyways, the good Lord saw me through that. After all that, I didn't have any pain. I never had to take any pain medicine. I mean, I had a double bypass, I had a kidney transplant, I still have this pacemaker. And I was never afraid because I knew the good Lord was there with me. I was never afraid. Now I have to take a lot of medicine to keep this kidney from being rejected. And I'm still considered a diabetic, but
Wise Red Road, came to take me down, have my dialysis done after my heart operation. And he, and we were going down, he said, "Boy, these hallways are cold." And I said, "Yeah, they always are. I wonder why." And I asked him, I said, "How are you doing today?" And all of a sudden, he just let it all out. He explained what he had gone through with his one of his sons, and with girls.
No problem.
I stand here today, sit here today, as living proof to you that we have a great and mighty God.
Amen.
You know him, can never tell me different. Thank you.
That are in life-controlling situations with drugs or alcohol or things like that. If you're brave enough to walk up here, we're going to pray for you right now because I believe there's a God that does a miracle. And he can give you victory even when your family doesn't have strength.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? I also believe that there are men that are here that the home life isn't what you think that the home life should be, and the enemy's trying to tear you down and tear you apart. There's victory today, not because of me, not because of you, but because quite a few of us have been fasting and praying for today, and Jesus is here. And the touch that you're going to get might not necessarily mean that things are immediately better at home, but you're going to have the strength not to endure, but to be the victor in the cause. So if that's you today, just make your way up here. We're not going to lay hands on everybody. We're just going to pray for those that are here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's good right there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise you, Father God. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Holy Spirit. We know, Lord, that there are many things in this world that are out of control.
Yes, God.
And that we have no control over ourselves. We have people that we have friends and family that need your help and need a touch from you, Lord. They're in trouble themselves. They don't know why. They're out of control. And they need someone to get a hold of them and pray for them. I ask this day, Lord, that you touch these people. Put your hands on them, Lord. Help them to get better, Lord. And guide these people who are out of control, the understanding how they can help. They don't know how to help them anymore, Lord. But you can.
Yes, God.
Put your hand on them also, Lord, and touch them and give them the strength and the courage to get through all this. Help them and show them that there is a mighty God, Lord, and can do anything, Lord. Anything. He can do anything, Lord, through you. Praise be to God. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Father, we also pray, Lord God, for fathers, Lord, for husbands, Lord God, for men, Lord, in general, Lord God. God, because you have ordained that they should be the heads of the household, Lord God. And God, we know that the enemy desires to tear them down, to rob their joy, to rob their confidence, Lord God, to rob their peace, Lord God, to rob sometimes their mental situation, Lord. But we know, Lord, that even as we pray for ourselves, there is one who is greater than we are that is standing at the right hand of Almighty God Himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, interceding for us, Lord. And God, begin to touch us, Lord, with a sensation that is not our own, Lord God. Lord, that we can do more than just endure, but we will be more than conquerors through Him who has loved us, Lord God. Lord, that you will establish us, Lord, from our risings up to our laying down, to our goings out, to our returnings again. And we shall not be shaken by situations. We shall not be shaken by users, Lord God. But we will be moved upon by the Spirit of the mighty God and be the strength that God desires for us to be.
Yes.
We ask it in Jesus' name, believing, Lord God, that you have spoken this to our hearts, Lord
yes,
God.
Jesus.
And God, that before the day is over, we will know the rising power of the Spirit of the living God within us. Hallelujah.
Yes,
hallelujah. Father, you said in the Psalms that we would be able to run through a troop and leap over a wall. God, begin to put that sensation of accomplishment and victory in us right now. In Jesus' blessed, holy, marvelous name. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Give God a hand.
Stand up here, but I know he has a leg that gives out on him every once in a while, so I told him, not for his sake, but for my sake, he had to sit. Just so you know that.